Om Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kansa Chanura Mardanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagad Gurum Om. Adorations to Lord Krishna, the preceptor of the universe, destroyer of the forces of darkness, and bestower of immortality. Om Shri Krishnaya Namah. Srimad Bhagavad Gita, chapter 17, known as Shraddhatraya Vibhaga Yoga, the yoga of threefold faith. And we have been giving insight into the role of faith in sadhana or in daily life. Even before your intellect hatches out of the chicken, hatches out of the egg, faith is there warming the egg, giving a crude illustration. Even before a baby is born, you see, there is a motherly warmth comes. And that's the most profound guiding movement in every heart. As you grow, then you begin to recognize the role of intellect. But intellect and faith has kind of a mother and baby relationship. We are now at this shloka number 14. You have been introduced to three types of yajna. And presently, the focus is on three types of tapa. Tapa is austerity. Three words are used, terms, yajna, dana, and tapa. Yajna relates to doing good to the cosmos. That's profounder meaning, srishti. The whole creation is involved in that movement. And that's why you hear in the, read the stories of Ramayana, Mahabharata. Rishis like Vishwamitra was performing yajna, not for himself, but for the sake of the world. So yajna relates to the entire creation. And society is given different insights into yajna. Every social activity can become a yajna. You are preserving your forests, securing animals and birds, doing things that are what these days science is involved, how to change the structure so that you have better climate, better weather. I will not go into that detail, that's the headache of the scientists. But Shraddha implies you don't have to know all the details. Your goodness has threefold effect. Effect on the whole creation. You don't know it. Effect on the society. Srishti, Samaj. And effect on your own individual personality. So these yajna, dana, and tapa, three words are used. Yajna relates you to the whole creation. Dana, act of charity and generosity, relates you to society. Tapas relates you to your own personality, body, mind, senses. How to train them, discipline your whole personality, that the purpose of tapas. But when you use these three words, don't go into any mathematical analysis. They are one and the same. spiritual movement has three aspects. It helps the whole creation in a very subtle way. It helps society, helps all humanity. And not just society and humanity, but all creation. And it helps your soul to attain liberation. So with this introduction, let me go into Devadvij Guru Prajna Pujanam Shaucham Arjavam Aprambhacharyam Ahimsacha Shariram Tapa Uchyate. Tapa term austerity. Focused on disciplining your body, mind and senses. Austerity has three aspects. Austerity of the body, austerity of your speech, austerity of your mind. Mind, speech and body. Manasa, vacha, karmana. Mental austerity, vocal austerity. Austerity in your daily action. Service of gods. First, Gita gives you a whole plan of threefold austerity. And then tells you what is sattvic, what is rajasic, what is tamasic. In the 14th verse, Devadvij Guru Prajna Pujanam, service of gods. We always put gods to make it convenient for the minds of the masses. Gods are not gods. The God in different poses. People whom you love, you may have taken many pictures of those people. Many poses of your father, many poses of your mother. If there are many people in the family, they all don't like the same pose. Each one chooses their own way. So when we speak of gods, in the beginning, mind that is like kid mind, it fascinates them and it becomes easy for your mind. I want money, I must worship Lakshmi. I want knowledge, I must worship Saraswati Devi. You want to remove obstacle, I must worship Hanuman. And in every religion, of course, they have their own way of thinking. Same God, if you are worshipping with limited attitude, instead of capital G, he becomes smaller G. And when you come to small g, G-O-D, there are many gods. Because many aspects of the God. So, whatever is your state of mind and whatever way you worship, nothing is being looked down upon. You are not being discouraged. Understand, the God is being worshipped by you no matter which way you turn your mind. And go on, flowing towards pleasing gods, their service of the gods. Next, service of Brahmins. A Brahmin doesn't relate to caste, but people who are deeply involved in disseminating spiritual knowledge. They have nothing else to do, they are retired from the world. But they're never tired of disseminating knowledge. No matter how tired they may be, retired. They are Brahmins. There was no other way to go. Brahman is their goal. Brahman is their reality. Next, one's guru. Just like if you take up any topic, any subject, and you want to be skilled in it, you have to find someone who is already skilled in that topic. And then acquired that knowledge. For example, music. You must not go on asking every monkey, can you teach me music? You have to ask someone who is skilled. And never go into the complex debate, why should I have a guru? I have to be independent. All this debate doesn't mean anything. Have a person who knows and be guided. And it's up to you, you can excel the teacher. Guru gud hi rahe, chela chini ho gaya. Guru is stayed, is a proverb which refers to how from sugar cane juice sweetness comes in two stages. First in crude stage called gud, and then it is further refined, it becomes sugar. I'm not giving you lessons on that, you see. That is allegorical way of saying encouraging the disciple that he can flourish more than himself. This again is a kind of tricky statement, because spiritual knowledge never changes. The guru that taught Vedanta 500, 600 years ago, that Vedanta is the same. But the disciple today will not use all their arguments. Because the arguments are already focused on snake on the rope. At the same time, they will not contradict those. But they will add to the language, to the literature, to the explanation, suited to the progressive time. They will not use Shakespearean language, hi ho. So never start thinking also in the terms of how the disciples excelled the guru. There is nothing to excel. Just like a child climbs upon the shoulder of the father, taps on his head, what you can't see, I see. And father says, oh yes. You are bigger than me. Next point, wise men. Pragya pujanam. Do not limit yourself after you have been guided by the guru. Don't become too limited that I have chosen one guru and I am absolutely faithful to him. I will never turn my head towards any other guru. There are people who do that. When guru dies, the mind stays completely closed. But that is not the real teaching, you see. Guru's teaching is not to restrict yourself. Teaching is to lead yourself to understand that the entire world is your guru. Therefore, Dattatreya opened the story of 24 gurus who are learning through wind, to the sky, through the clouds, to the birds, to the ocean. Which doesn't, again, what I'm already leading you to understand, that you can turn to any source of satsanga, anywhere that you can get inspired. And naturally you become involved in seva karya. If you want if you receive Guru's guidance, then you also serve Guru and many things. Next point, Shaucham. Shaucham means purity. Purifying your body, Shauch is two types, physical, mental. Purifying your body, that's, you don't need explanations. It is, ask any doctor or medical people, how they give you whole mantra how to wash your hands. How to put a flap over your nose. All these details again, I'm not going to go into. Physical purity is of immense importance. There again, you can cheat. Don't even bathe, put on wonderful clothes. Or you can cheat it in a more subtle way. Eat things that are so nasty that your inner core is constantly agitated. Impurity is internally bubbling all over. So all that is called ashauch, impurity of the body. And that's a big task that one must go on every day. There is no way you can stop it. And antar shuddhi. Similarly, just like you every day must apply water, soap and all that for purifying the body, should go on looking into the mind. Mind is your higher level of your higher personality, and dirt deposits upon your mind. Rajas comes in. Go on wiping away the rajas, throwing away your unnecessary worries, unnecessary anxieties, unnecessary informations gather in your mind. You go to sleep and say, what's happening in Australia? What's happening in New Zealand? Science has come up with the discovery of a special planet. What's happening there? I'm just giving you a broad way to understand. At the same time, I'm not saying that your mind should be closed. But don't let all this become like a dirt on your mind. Like every day you sit upon your seat and you wipe it away, all the dust. So all, so many things come in your mind like dust. Wipe them away, because that's not the reality. That simply obstructs your life. I'll give you a little episode from some stories. Once some intellectual scholars wanted to debate with Saint Kabira. And Kabira, knowing their intention, he kept himself in a little hut or room or whatever it was, and brought a little pig near him and started petting the pig. Now you must understand, if you don't find that story in Purana, don't worry about it. Those were scholars came and they saw. That's a shame, shame, shame. This man is surrounded by hell. And he also shouted out, shame, shame, my hell is outside, your hell is inside. I've kept my pig out, your pig is inside. So if antar shauch is not there, think of the pig inside you. Next term is used, arjavam. Therefore, the term Arjuna comes from arjava. Arjava means straightforward. Be connected with thought, word and deed. That should be a good connection. If that connection is not there, you cannot advance, neither in a worldly way nor in a spiritual way. And if your personality has not developed that in a crude way, you are illustrated in the form of mantra, kubadi, hunchbacked. No matter how straight you are. So arjavam, that always has to be what you are thinking, how you speak and how you act. There should be attunement. But there are people who don't even know what they are thinking. And having said so many things, they don't know what they have said. Having mashed up so many things by hand, they don't know what. It's lack of arjava. Next point, brahmacharyam. Disciplining your body so that you do not live in society in a pervert way. Avoiding perverted movements of the body. And that's physical brahmacharya. And again, it comes into vocal words that excite people in a passionate way. I'm talking about perverted time. And thoughts that are constantly in a perverted level, all those mind must sublimate that type of urge, that type of movement. Certain movements in human personality are instinctive. All animals and birds follow an instinctive flow of progeny, how to create children. Human beings can't be in that level. So, bringing about a control, and also to understand that deep down you are neither man nor woman. So as soul, you should not be constantly gripped by sex awareness. It should completely become transformed. And then experience of profound love becomes much more real for you. Otherwise, love that is experienced by the masses, that's a vulturous love. As long as there is something there to feed on, the vulture loves. This, however, I'm not condemning or underestimating the normal role of sex life in humanity. That's perfectly normal. That's divine. That's called brahmacharya. And ultimately, brahmacharya word, you must understand that type of conduct that leads you to Brahman. That's called brahmacharya. Ahimsa. Another point. Just as you don't admit, rather don't allow any injury to take place to your body. How careful you are. Understand others have the same experience. And don't therefore direct your mind towards hurting others. And if you are hurt by others, there again, try to develop patience, endurance, understanding. And this is illustrated in a simple way. If your teeth bite your tongue, how do you feel? Whom are you angry with? So that type of relation is the ideal. The ideal has to be pursued day by day. And you don't succeed 100% immediately. It takes its own time. But no matter how much, how long it may take, that is a healthy movement. But all these are the related to, at this stage, Gita is talking about physical aspect of all this practice. You are trying to practice all in a very physical way, then called physical austerity. 15th verse. Anudvegataram vakyam satyam priyahitam chayat swadhyaya vyasanam chaiva vangmayam tapa uchyate. Anudvegakaram vakyam. First let me give you the translation. Speech which does not cause agitation in others, which is truthful, pleasant and helpful. And the repeated study of scriptures, these constitute the austerity of speech. It's the literal translation. Now let me give you deeper meaning. The first statement in this, anudvega karam vakyam, words that should not hurt others, must realize the role of words. Sometimes physical hurt due to your action, somebody, that hurt will easily removed from your mind, you forget about it. But vocal hurt, in the midst of people who invited a person and in front of others, you condemned the person, criticized the person just because a little paint was there in the nose. I'm joking. I'm joking, but you can imagine what I'm meaning behind. Hurtful words. Those words people will remember for a long, long time. It's like a nail entering in the heart. So you should not underestimate the value of words. If you make your words cheap, then where is your character? The strength of your soul diminishes. That's what the scripture talked about, satyavadita. People who have observed their truth and go on emphasizing how Rama and all the line of Raghus, Harishchandra, Ravashashivi and many, and whole line of sages and saints, they were proud of whatever they utter, that has to be absolutely truth. Now, first, I was emphasizing that your words should not hurt others. And that you have to think of many people do that in so many ways. Sometimes, verbally, you are saying things that are very pleasing to a person. Like I tell the story of fables. The fox looks at the bird. Bird has a little piece of meat. And fox is hungry. He wants the meat in his own mouth. So what does he do? They're saying, oh, and the bird is a crow. Oh, you beautiful crow. Poets don't think about you. But I proclaim you more beautiful than anybody. Look now, the sun shining upon you. Were shining, were most beautiful. Surely your voice will be more sweeter than your whole personality. And the bird hears it, opens the beak, crow, crow. Beat falls, fox takes it. Goodbye. Hindi word is chapalusi. Say fascinating words to allow your selfish purpose fulfilled. And that's, though it doesn't appear we're hurting, but it is same thing as hurting. Worse than that. So anudvega karam vakyam, so far I've been explaining that point. How to use your words that do not agitate others. Satyam, another point, your words should be based on reality, truth, as you understand. It should come from your sincere heart. Now, speak the truth. Now, further extension in that point. Priyam hitam. Satyam vada, na vada satyam apriyam. Speak the truth, but don't become like Duryodhana. Or rather, Mahabharata gives a whole story of Duryodhana. Was in a daze, in a special type of magical city. And Draupadi laughed at Duryodhana, saying, look at the son of a blind man. Duryodhana was a son of a blind man. But even though the statement is literally true, but the intention was totally different. And Duryodhana takes it and it hurts him so much that this becomes a big part of the story of a great war. Behind that again there is subtler meaning. I'm not taking that topic now. But only the illustration. Sometimes you are speaking the truth, but your intention is not really the truth. Intention is to degrade the person. It's like someone has come to you and shows how great he is and very successful, and you are very jealous. And suddenly, do you know? Have you contacted your ancestry? Who was your grandfather? This may be perfectly true, factual. But I'm just illustrating how many people in the world, they have become a tremendously crude personalities in the name of truth. They pick up gossip from one person, put it into the website, and go into virals in the name of truth. And that's the worst thing, that's not truth. We're propagating hatred. So, truth you must speak, but it should be pleasant. And next point should be helpful. If it is, it has no purpose, then why do you have to unnecessarily waste your verbal energy? Unnecessary palabras. Do not be labar. Lavar is palavra. Lavar is drip, 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 all the words flow from your tongue. Like the liquid flowing from the dog's tongue. Repeated study of scriptures. Another point in this austerity of speech. Swadhyaya term, it literally relates to studying scriptures, but it has many implications. Swadhyaya relates to being involved in japa, involved in chintan, thinking about God and His glories. So this whole process of study, constant repetition, constant reflection. To the masses, this goes on abruptly. You are thinking of all types of things. Your swadhyaya has no purpose. But your study is vast. The information you gather is so immense. But it doesn't have much purpose. It doesn't change your personality. It doesn't give you any benefit. If that is so, then that swadhyaya is not the high type. Otherwise, this is an enriching process, swadhyaya. So all these are the important points for the practice of austerity. Now let me point out 16th verse. Manah prasadah shaumyatvam maunam atmavi nigraha bhava sanshuddhi ityetat tapo manasa uchyate. Serenity of mind, gentleness, silence, control of senses, and an elevated feeling of the heart. Elevated means inspiring feeling. These constitute the austerity of the mind. Already we have given the basis behind all this process of thinking. Austerity of the mind, highlighting the mind, what should the mind, how should the mind move? These points have to be remembered. Manah prasada. Mind should be serene. Time being short, I'm trying to now give you very brief. Dabra prasanna vritti. Keep your mind cheerful. Do not allow your mind to sink in sadness. And that you have to work out in your own person. What helps you? Walk into the garden, talk to the birds, sing. Listen to something that changes your mind. Read some scriptures, do japa, whatever. But do not allow your mind to stay in a sorrowful state. Another point, do not entertain heen vritti, thought waves that degrade you as well as others. Implying you sit back and say, what bad karma. As well as, worse than that, what bad karmas all these people have done. They don't belong to my religion. So whenever you go anywhere, you are constantly filling your mind with heena vritti, degrading thoughts. Third point, though busy in life, keep busy, purposefully. A river must flow in order to be pure and shining. Life must flow in order to receive a kind of spiritual sunshine. So while allowing yourself to flow, constant atmachintan, a constant touch of divine aspect. In other words, do japa, feel you are an instrument in divine hand. Feel that your whole personality can shine if you develop divine virtues. Always remember that Hanuman-Ram relation, deha-buddhyatu-dasoham. From physical point of view, I'm an instrument. Jiva-vidya-tvadanshaka. From the point of view of my soul, I'm a ray of God. So we have every right to be God-like, not ungod-like. And atma-vidya-tvayivaham. And deep down, mano buddhi cittani naham, not all this, as Shankaracharya. I'm neither mind, nor intellect, nor ego, nor the body, nor the senses. I'm not the pranas. I'm not the elements. Giving a very quick touch of Vedanta, I am not all this. That type of internal feeling must go on developing while you are continuing to operate in life. And when you deal with people, do not keep your mind focused on finding defects in others. If you do so, there is no harm. But if you do it with a motherly heart, your five children, you look at them and start looking at their defects. Recognizing their defects even before they recognize their defects. If you recognize defects in others with that type of heart, having recognized their defects, what do? You don't condemn them, you don't degrade them. You deal with them in lovingly. Under a loving environment, you try to persuade people. If you can't do that, keep yourself aloof. But not curing problems with a blow. It's the old time. A child made a mathematical mistake, the teacher gave a big slap. He can't even think after that. So if that type of bhavana develops, that's called austerity, mental austerity. So with this I will conclude. Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.